Hi, my name is Annika. Do you know that feeling of having intimacy with another or with yourself and just not feeling fulfilled? So the question is, do you really know what you want? Do you know how a yes feels in your body and how a no feels in your body? And really from your body and not from a rational headspace? And are you completely aware of how do you want to be touched? And how do you want to touch another? And if you do so, how do you communicate this in a clear and loving way? This and other topics I'm covering in my workshops, and I look forward to welcoming you there. Find me on Facebook or Insta with my name Annika Lipp, AnnikaLipp. Or contact me via WhatsApp 079-3517-864. Get in touch with me via my website annikalipp.com or Insta Annika Lipp or Facebook Annika Lipp. So my name is written like this: Annika, AnnikaA, and my surname Lipp, LIPP. Looking forward to hear from you.
Sometimes we're looking for the more, but we just don't know what the more is. And then we come to play with me. Three words, like me, play, toys, fun, games, cheekiness, with, intimacy, connection, relationships, and finally me. It starts with self, and that is something that Play With Me stands for. Play With Me is a place where you have an experience of all of those things. One complete cycle. You're welcome to pop in at our shop at the gantry in Four Ways, or find us at www.playwithme.co.za. If you're looking for that more, please get in touch.
Ready to deepen in love? Join me on a transformative journey with Tantra. I'm Tara Rose, inviting you into more connection, more intimacy, more love in your relationship with another or with yourself. Tantra is more than sex. It's a path that uses the body for expansion. In our sessions, we can explore bliss, love, emotional pain, ignite your life force energy, and create a safe space for growth. I guide women, men, and couples, in person or online, blending traditional and neo-tantra. This can be a profound journey to deepen your bond with your partner and recognize your true self. Book a discovery call at tararose.net, tararose.net, or message on WhatsApp, +27 76 535 5949. Tantra with Tara Rose. Activate, nourish, and enrich your mind, body, and spirit.
The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views or positions of any entities they represent, or that of the program, its presenters, hosts, directors, or other team members.
This show is intended for audiences aged 23 and older. This production and its digital copies contain content of an adult nature. If you are easily offended or are under the age of 18, this show is not intended for you. The posts, pages, and recordings within are intended for adults only and may include descriptions of scenes of sexual content, suggestive opinions, detailed discussions, and graphic topics. Listener discretion is advised.
Good evening, lustfuls. Welcome to lesson 10 in semester 3 of Lola's Lessons. Listen, lustfuls, we're still bloody trending, right? I mean, the world loves sex education at its best. Apparently, the world loves Lola and they love Carmen too. Aren't we just lucky? I mean, as a blonde and a brunette, can you go wrong? No, you can't. Let me start off the evening by mentioning the endorsement site, Lola's favorite friends at the Council of Fantasy. The Council of Fantasies is a lifestyle-orientated community like all the lustful listeners know by now, right? I mean, if you haven't joined us, why not? Do you not have goals or do I need to send you some? Come join us at the Council of Fantasy, www.councilofantasy.co.za. Otherwise, you guys can head on over to Lola's website. That is www.lelust, yes, lelovelies, lelust with a double L, lelustfm.live. Go down to the bottom of the homepage, click on the WhatsApp icon, and come join the WhatsApp community. I mean, there's an education group, there's a lifestyle group. Yes, a lifestyle group, Ms. Carmen, means it's a group for non-monogamous folk, right? All of them join together in this group. Yeah, that's what they do there. There's a BDSM group. I mean, it's really a fun community. People make friends. People have lots of laughs. They also have hookups, which is great. I mean, we love the lot of them. Your Lola Blakely moderators, production moderators for this evening are Miss Big Red. Hi, Miss Big Red. She'll be moderating and keeping an eye on the discussion and topic. We've got a Zern Fona, hello, hottie, moderating and doing the disclaimer for us. My other wifey, Miss Medusa, will be doing welcomes and countdowns for y'all. And then production manager this evening in KB's Avesigheid would be Mr. Black Dragon himself. If you guys see them in the chat, say hi, give them a wave, send them a bloody donut. They work hard, right? They're here to engage with our listeners and keep us safe during the airing. Feel free to ask them any questions, send them a wave, say hi. Also, now can I say hello to my gorgeous blonde bombshell of a co-host, Miss Carmen Illy. I mean, did you dress up for Lola this evening?
I always dress up for Lola. You must know this.
I mean, I put my face on for you. You know this.
I noticed.
I even put powder on the faces. This is all for you. I want to look beautiful for you. I don't know who's luckier, you or me.
Probably me.
Miss Carmen, how was your week?
My week was great. I had my cake and I ate it, as you will know. Okay.
Yes, because Miss Carmen got a year older. I mean, a year younger.
Yeah.
Can we tell the lesson? I mean, it's out now. Everybody knows. Also, why didn't you get like the lesson? Last little listeners even buy your presents. They better go and drop that shit off at play with me. Otherwise, it's going to be a hard to buy.
I know. I was properly spoiled. Hey? I felt very blessed and good. Very spoiled. And lots of cake, lots of candles, lots of love. We had a wonderful rope workshop at the shop. So it was just a tremendously brilliant week.
That's fantastic. It sounds like a real Pisces week to me.
It was.
Love it. Listen, lustful listeners, we've got a great episode this evening. Combs, what do you know about lust?
I know it feels so nice.
It does, right? It's like eating from the forbidden fruit. Isn't it wonderful?
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
But here's the thing, right? I think if you really ever found love, I think, personally, I mean, I wouldn't know. Do I know? I don't know. I don't know what I don't know, right? That's Carmen's favorite saying. So, we don't know. Does love even feel better? Have we even experienced real love? Do we know what the shit is all about?
I feel like it's a difference between a jalapeno and a, what's your favorite one again?
A Carolina Reaper. That's like the world's hottest chili. That's my favorite chili. I can eat the most of it. Listen, it's fucking hot. But, I mean, so am I, so... Lucky lucky me and lucky chili, I think.
And this is okay, why I'm here, okay?
Listen, how did we possibly get from lust to bloody talking about chilies? I can't. This breaks my brain on the daily. So yes, I think it is. It's the difference between lust and love. It's possibly like the difference between a jalapeno and a Carolina Reaper.
Yes.
The one is just absolutely extreme. But which one of the extremes do you want to be? Do you want one without the other? I personally want a little bit of both. Here's the thing, right? I haven't told you, but I'm throwing another thing in here this evening. You know me and my alliterations, right? I love everything to alliterate. So I've decided we're doing like, lust, and love.
Like?
Yes, because I like you, but I also lust you and I love you.
So it's like nice.
No, it's not like that.
Is our show nice? Hey?
No, our show's lovely.
It's like, no, this is not like well tried instead of well done, you know?
No, no. Look, and here's the thing, right? You and I don't know. That's why we've got the wonderful guests that we've got this evening. And
we have amazing guests, yes.
Are the listeners in for a bloody treat this evening? These ladies are absolutely phenomenal. And seeing the two of them together, because, I mean, they are friends after all, seeing them together and do this together, listen, tonight is going to blow the listeners' minds. And let me not even, like, extend it any further. Let me introduce this evening's guests. We have got Tara Rose back. Tara Rose is a tantric practitioner who is also, Auntie Carmen just wants you to please hypnotize her again. Tara Rose is a tantric practitioner who weaves energy and bodywork, family constellations, tantric and trauma-involved practices together to create a sacred container where you can become curious adventurers of your own inner and outer worlds. She facilitates journeys that bring you closer to your essence, that part where you are always in touch with your sacredness, passion, wisdom, and purpose of life. Tara Rose has presented international online tantra and family constellation events. Based in Cape Town, she offers in-person and online private coaching, as well as workshops and retreats. The Lola Blakey production moderators will be sharing Tara's links and her socials on the Podbean app. For those who are possibly catching the rerun of this, I'll give it to you so long. You can find her at tararose.net or at tararose.net. That would be her web. Otherwise, you guys can hit her up on email on tara@tararose.net. I'm not going to give her WhatsApp number out. We'll post that on socials. But it's going to be South African area code, like you will hear in the ad, right? It's also the second time Tara's joining us this evening in this season. And she was a guest on episode 2 of season 3 during our segment on Tantra Time. And she's the one that absolutely hypnotized myself and Carmen on air. It was absolutely phenomenal. Go listen to that episode. Don't miss it. And then, I mean, we've also got another blonde and a brunette. So Tara's brunette, and then we've got a gorgeous blonde as well. Annika is a tantric and ceremonial practitioner dedicated to the pursuit of truth, valuing honesty, authentic connections, and clear communications. She holds workshops and events in the field of Tantra. Annika is deeply passionate about empowering others to embrace and embody their authentic selves, guiding them on a journey towards greater self-discovery and truth. She joined us on episode 2 of season 1 of Kinky Classes, and she explained consent to us in the most beautiful way. I learned so much. You guys can get hold of Annika on www.annikalipp.com. Alternatively, her email address, lip.annika, that's with a double P, listeners, lip.annika@gmail.com. I mean, these two absolutely phenomenal tantric coaches are joining us this evening because, let's be honest, right, there's a big difference between lust and love. And we can't have one person explain this. And these two ladies are absolutely phenomenal and perfectly picked, in my personal opinion, for this episode. So without further ado, Annika, Tara, thank you so much for joining us again. Thank you for being here with us and for dedicating time to teaching our lustful listeners something about lust and love and the differences between the two. Annika, are you there?
Yes, here I am.
Yeah. There we go. Oh, and your sound check is absolutely perfect. It sounds brilliant. Hip hip hooray. Tara, welcome. Thank you so much for you joining us as well. We're so excited to have the two of you back. Have you guys had a good week?
Yes, my weekend was really beautiful. was a beautiful public holiday yesterday. Yeah. And now I could not imagine to spend my evening on a Friday better than with you, beautiful teams and all the listeners. I'm very, very happy to be back.
Oh, we are so blessed to have you. So let's give the listeners an idea, right? Comms, did you listen to the meeting we had? Did you even spoil yourself like that?
Of course I spoiled myself like that. How else do you know me?
So, okay. So, because I wanted to keep it a surprise, actually. let's open the discussion, right? Let's start off and let's start off soft. So I'm thinking for this segment, right? When you start, before you get serious, obviously you need to start at this. You tell a story from the beginning, right? You need to start dating from the beginning too. So you go to a club or a pub, you see that guy at the opposite side of the dance floor. Oh, he's a hottie. He's got a little bit of muscle, but not too much. He's got that sneaky smile. And you like this. I mean, you like, maybe there's a little bit of a bulge in the chest area, Lustles. He's maybe got a nice broad chest, right? And this guy looks like a buff. And he's drinking water, so he's not a big drinker. You like this, right? What is like, where do we start dating? How do you know if you like somebody in the aspect of a relationship or just as friends? Tara, how can you maybe tell us, like, what in your opinion would you say defines like very well?
Yeah, for me, and I also just want to say, you know, hello to everyone, and it's really wonderful to be back and in this, you know, delicious craziness with the two of you and with my dear friend Annika. Yeah, you're asking me how my week was. Actually, we saw each other on Wednesday night at an art exhibition opening on Shibari. So, yeah, that was a good start to this kind of long weekend, longish weekend. But to answer your question, for me, like is for me, like, I don't know, I can think of in the context more of like friends, and where I have a strong emotional connection and not necessarily a physical, lustful, sexual connection, not necessarily along. Actually, there can be commitment in that liking as well. So like is a whole spectrum as well. But yeah, appreciation, like you said, for the guy with the muscles or the, you know, that kind of thing, just an appreciation also for me signifies like.
I agree with that, actually, because it doesn't necessarily always have to be sexual. Like I said, it can be in a friendship kind of way as well. I mean, comms, I like you very much. Mm-hmm. But what is like to you?
I think like is vibes. Like, I'm very big on vibes. You know that, hey? Like, I can sense the vibes before we've even had the conversation. But as you were describing the guy at the bar, I was like, I wonder what he smells like. Maybe that comes later.
You see in high definition. I love it.
But yes, that's, it's vibes. I sense energies, and that's pretty much how I've always been, you know. So you can tell in the first few seconds, really, you know, yes, we're going to get along or not. I mean, that's just, and you would gravitate towards or you wouldn't. That's how it is for me, at least.
I think it works well for me personally. I'm very much about vibrations. So your inner vibration, well, I think your inner core is either going to vibrate with that person or it's not. If you're not going to like that person, if something in your core values just don't agree with them, then you're not going to feel comfortable around that person. So that I can also figure out very quickly whether I like or dislike somebody. And if I dislike you, I don't want to spend time in your presence. Like, thank you, I've had enough, goodbye. My vibration's just, maybe it's not something you've done, right? There's just something about the vibration that's off. Annika, how do you see it? What do you think? What do you think, is it about somebody else that possibly attracts us the first time to initiate a relationship?
Yeah, I really like what Carmen said when she said it's all about the vibes, because I see it exactly like this. It's like a conscious, unconscious feeling of just getting a feeling of the person. And now that I'm working more and more energies, now I can say like, oh, I really like that energy. And before that, I just felt like drawn to this person just from the energetic field. And then, you know, when we are speaking, are there same values? Do we appreciate the same things, or do we have shared interests? Yeah. And often also what I often find, especially with friends, or at least until now, especially with friends, I'm often drawn to people who have qualities which I don't have. Yeah. So I'm like, oh, that is fantastic. You are so good in that. So I'm drawn to this person. So maybe also here, more conscious or more unconscious than conscious, that I can grow with this person. And also what you guys said already, this liking is for a romance, for a maybe relationship, but also for friends or for my neighbor or for my work colleagues. Yeah, so it's like, it's also the emotional resonance. Just like, feels good. I'm feeling comfortable in your present, and I want to grow with you. I want to explore things with you.
Tara, do you think all likes that give you that butterfly feeling in your stomach, you know, the pit of your stomach, like when you see that person, something inside you just like crumbles, your body's like, and I actually think it was Annika that said that, is that a yes, or really a yes? Can you feel it in your body? So when you feel that you're around this person and you feel that, like that butterflies, do you think all of these should go over into relationships and would eventually turn into love?
For me, the butterflies in the stomach is going a little bit closer to lust and romantic love. So I totally agree with what Annika and Carmen were saying about that, just that energy and the vibes. Like for me, that's a different feeling in my body when it's like, I like someone. It's almost comforting. That butterfly in the stomach feeling is a little bit more edgy. Those are different kind of hormones at play. So yeah, I'm not sure if I answered the question properly, but yeah, the butterflies in the stomach for me is lust and romantic love.
Absolutely. Let's talk about infatuation. Carmen, have you ever been infatuated with somebody?
Yes. I would not like to divulge all of that right here and now.
I mean, look at me putting you on the spot.
By the way, Lola, you're out of milk.
Listen, that's my line. You can't steal that.
Oh, so I have actually, and I mean, it becomes, I don't know, infatuation, where it's like, you know, the constant thinking of and the constant online stalking of, and I wonder what, you know. I have experienced that in my life, yes. Have you?
Oh gosh, have I? Absolutely. I think, and that's possibly one of my dangerous aspects, right? Is I like playing on the extreme side of emotions. I'm a Leo, so I'm always all in. I'm either all in or I'm all out. I'm not, there is no gray area with me. So when I love hard. When I'm interested in something or someone, I'm interested hard, like I lust the most. And that's why I thought of the segment is for personal reasons, absolutely for personal reasons, because I wanted to know, how do I know I'm just lusting after this person? How do I actually, because nobody teaches you this shit, Carmen. No, there's no school or class in school that goes, listen, this is what love feels like, right? Write this in the top right-hand corner of your book in like Fastgriff. This is what lust looks like, okay? And you can color it in with a red pen. Nobody does that. There's no fucking book for this. I want to know. If I look at somebody and I get that feeling at the pit of my stomach, I want to know, do I love you or do I lust you? Or are you going to waste my time, or do I need to ask you to marry me the next leap year? You know, these are important life tricks that you need to be made aware of. Carmen, you've got your finger up and your hand in the air. What do you want to add?
I'm just going to say thank goodness for Lola's lessons so I can hear about this at the tender age of 42. But anyway, just quickly back to infatuation. I think oftentimes with something like infatuation, as I have experienced it and understand it, it would also be that with respect to someone who's unattainable. So, you know, like Jared Leto.
Yes.
Or, you know, Nicole Kidman. Because, you know, you can be all infatuated with them. It doesn't mean it's going to become a reality. You know what I mean?
Madonna's
so there's
my
the
thing.
Real infatuation and the real life. Is it Madonna?
Oh, for real? Gosh. Listen, that woman. You've got no idea. Let's move on before I slip off my seat.
Let's.
Annika, we are, you know what? I'm just going to throw you on the spot here too. Let's give you lust to explain to us. I think lust works very well with you. Do you think infatuation can quickly boil over into lust?
It can, but it does not have to. Because for me, it is different. So an infatuation, for me, it's like sometimes I like it and sometimes it's so uncomfortable. It's this emotions high and low of like, this person is always in my mind. It drives me crazy. And then, then I daydream about the person. How beautiful. And then we meet. And I'm so like, what the heck? Where do we meet? What am I wearing? And many people I know love this face. I hate it. I hate this face of thing. And infatuation could be, in my experience, also too much. You know, it's like it's a little bit overwhelming attraction. Yeah,
it's like an obsessive compulsive disorder, but just in a feeling.
Yeah. So I'm leading. I'm going now to lust, and yes, I love to be in lust. Absolutely. So often lust regards as one of the primal forces driving human behavior. And I'd completely agree. It is so amazingly powerful. Mm. And I mean, there must be a reason, right? When we are looking at where we find lust, literature, art, culture throughout the history are playing with the topic of lust. Yeah. So for me, lust is very complex and it's a multifaceted emotion. And it's also often a misunderstood force that resides there, but it is in every one of us. So if you, one of the team or one of the listener, feel like lust, I forgot what it is, I don't have that anymore, trust me, you do. It's in all of us. Yeah, maybe it sleeps at the moment, but you definitely can wake it up. Yeah, so it is a very primal energy. And this primal energy that can lead to both profound spiritual, amazing experiences, but also could be also destructive behaviors if it's not properly understood and harnessed. So back to very, very powerful. I stop here because I can talk now for an hour, but maybe that's a little bit too boring for you guys.
Look, and you've got me intrigued, Joe. So I'm one of those people, when I do something, I got to be the best. Right, when I did athletics in school, I got to be number one. There's no way you're beating me. If you're going to beat me, I'm not even going to participate, right? That's me. So is that almost like having a lustful drive to succeed? I mean, really wanting that job. Can that also be seen as a form of, you know, that kind of obsession that you were talking about?
Yeah, I mean, lust is definitely not just when we are talking about sex. It's also definitely in lust for power, lust for wealth, lust for material possessions. And yeah, maybe also lust for I want to be the best. Yeah, that could be. Mm. Could be, yeah.
The want. Carmen, have you got the want too? You always want to want. Suki, my mom, the Suki genoem.
Yes, you know that about me. I'm a lustful co-host.
Listen, I was told this week that I need to stop calling the listeners lustful. So I'm just going to call them lovelies from now on, because apparently, like, the world has issues with it. Luckily, that's their issues and not our issues, right? Annika, how do you say we would differentiate lust from something like or something like love?
Yeah, so the like is, for example, so for me, it starts with an attraction. There must be it trigger something that I'm drawn to this person and I want to know this person more, right? So then we are going into liking, like, oh, we have things in common. I like your energy. We have similar values. And then, A, my body kicks in and my sacral chakra, where I have my creativity and my sexual flow, my sexual energy is like, I want to have intimacy, physical intimacy with you, kicks in. So, and this is in my point of view, or like say in my experience, because it's so sweet at the beginning, you said, yeah, we have Tara and Annika here because they know a lot, but obviously it's also limited, at least for my knowledge. So I speak a lot about my experience. So for me, I would struggle to go in a love relationship from liking to love because I'm caring for you. I personally, because I'm a quite sexual person, I definitely need the lust. And from the lust, so I'm in a lust phase. From the liking, then I'm quite long in a lust phase. And for me personally, then the lust phase can bring another phase, which is love. Yeah, it's not going straight, it's overlapping. So when I'm not just interested to have the most amazing sex with my lover, but I really care for him, when he comes
you want that connection, that
incredible
intimacy.
Sex with me, I prepare a chocolate cake for him. I am asking how he's doing. Then we are going more and more into love.
I love that. Comms?
You see, I always want to have my cake and eat it. There's feedback here.
It's not me. My mic is off.
Is that better? There we go.
It's much better.
So just on that, how do we go from, okay, so we're liking and then we're lusting and it's that burning desire in the belly, you know, and we all know it. We can't keep our hands off of each other. And then we go into love. And I have experienced in love, lust as well. And I would very much like to understand by the end of this podcast how we maintain levels of lust in love phase as well. Because for me, it's a process of, it's the journey, right? That's how I understand it.
Yes, yes, you just stole my tagline.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry. No, but that's absolutely great because that's exactly what I want out of this. I don't think that a marriage can have a successful intimate relationship if you don't have a little bit of both. That's my personal opinion, and I want to know if I'm right. I want to know if the listeners feel the same. I want to know if the coaches feel the same. I want to know what everybody else knows because I want to understand this. I want the listeners that have relationships, that's interested in enhancing their intimacy, I want them to take something home where they can say, oh, okay, well, I know I love my partner because I've been married to them for the longest time. Maybe I should add a little bit of lust. How do we find lust, Annika? If you've been married to your partner for 25 years, right? I mean, you've grown old, you've evolved, you've redesigned Carmen, you've redesigned your relationship a couple of times. You redesigned that shit, and now you get to a point where you've possibly evolved a little bit apart as well. And you've lost that intimacy. How do we start working on our lust within our relationship?
Yeah, that's a very valuable question. So first of all, for me personal, lust also starts with myself. Like I said at the beginning, you know, like if someone feels like, oh, I haven't felt lust for a while, it is there. So I really encourage all of us to, on a regular basis, to give ourselves self-love with several things, but also with, like, you know, taking a bath. When you put your body lotion on yourself, really, like, consciously, like, wow, I really like the contact with you. So really also to invite our senses, yeah? When you eat something delicious, be aware, how does it feel? How does the sensation of your shirt or a touch feels on your body? So for me, lust starts with myself. And I have to say, for this podcast, I got so like, oh my gosh, I pushed my laptop to the side and self-pleasured. Yeah, because just the idea of lust in myself was so like, delicious, this beautiful, beautiful life force. Yeah.
This excites me.
And so this is what I recommend all of us. You know, we can't say, hey, I'm not feeling lust. Maybe there's something wrong with me. Maybe there's something wrong with a partner. It is there. So really start with yourself. Mm-hmm. Give yourself the self-love, the self, the lust. And then the fire starts within you. And yes, I can imagine, I say, I can imagine, because I haven't been in a very long relationship yet. So yeah, so I can imagine that it drops, that it decreases. So how can we bring this lust back? So maybe we just imagine, how was it at the beginning? Yeah, it was
going back to the
beginning, because we didn't know everything. We explored things together. And why?
You didn't know all of those horrible things that your partner does, like leaving his socks fucking everywhere.
Yeah.
Like, you didn't know those things back then. So it was just all about lust. Sorry to interrupt you, but yeah, I just had to throw that out there. Don't leave your socks everywhere. That's disgusting.
Yeah, so I encourage people who have a long time together, try out new things together. Don't go always to your favorite Thai restaurant. Try something new. Yeah, or do together a cooking course. Again, food can be very central. Feed yourself, feed each other, yeah? Or do exercise together, or spontaneously visit your partner at work and give them a kiss or a muffin, or ask if they have time for lunch. So it is, on one side, I am, with my honesty background, I would love to have no secrets between me and my partner. Still, this like, ooh, there are surprises. There's some mystery. This is
mystery.
What, in my kind of view, is kindling and rekindling the lust in a long-term relationship. Not talking about all the play, the place, and you know, hey, you're just pretending I don't know you, and I pick you up at the bar, and then we have sex at the toilet. Obviously, you can also do this, all this role plays as well to rekindle your lust.
Just make sure the toilet is clean, please.
Yeah, exactly.
I love that. I think it's very important to, if especially for our new couples and you know, the new relationship, the fresh relationships, those guys that are still very much in lust and in love phase, right? Hold the fuck onto that, because that is gold. Don't let it go. Don't fall into that routine. Don't get used to your partner. Do something spontaneous. Do something exciting. Keep that excitement there, right? Combs, do you think there's other reasons why people fall out of lust?
I think it's because everything becomes quite mundane. We actually lack quite a bit of creativity, and I see that often in my daily. And I can also be like that. I mean, you know, I've got to hold myself accountable. So if we go back to, you know, when you first meet someone, what are we doing more of? We're laughing together. You know, we're happy to go out and do go-karting and go find things to do. And then eventually over time, that just kind of wanes. And I think that we become stuck in the rut. Hello, what's for dinner? It's logistics, boring, okay? I really like that activating of all the senses. So trying new things, you know, I mean, the cooking and pressing your own buttons, you know, I like that part too. So yes, I think that we need to be actually prioritizing and putting that conscious effort in. That's important.
So Miss Tara has been so good in just listening. And I like that, because it means she's taking everything in and she's going to have a lot to say. So Miss Tara, I see you very much as like a central. I mean, we've spoken to you before, right? We've had this interview before. So you're very much sensual. You're very much about that intimacy, that love, that intense connection. Do you see space for lust within a lovable, loving, and honorable relationship?
When you ask me that question, just instinctively, I say yes. And I know from, I've gone on a big journey with mainly with love and the different types of love, and at some points kind of trying to understand what the fuck is happening to me. why do I have these roller coaster emotions? Like, what is going on? So I actually have done a lot of my own personal research about love, and got kind of went down these rabbit holes in terms of the the psychological theories of love, and then the you know, neuroscience theories of love. So kind of depending on the framework that you're looking at it, it can, you know, lust fits in kind of in a continuum or as a part of what love is. And a lot of people describe lust just as physical, as the physical, really raw physical emotion. So, and then you going into, let's say, like romantic love, which is also like the intense, it's like the emotional bond, you can't stop thinking of them, you know, like the infatuation, like I'm a huge candidate for that one.
Oh, really?
I get like really caught in, and then the pain if it's like unrequited, that unrequited love that you were talking about, like of the, you know, people who don't even know.
Tara, we blushed you there. Okay, Tara, I'm going to ask you just to go out of the room. Can you hear me? Okay, you can hear me. Okay, I'm going to ask you just to go out, Tara Contillo. So, Tara, I'm just going to ask you to go out of the room. Or actually, hold on, just unmute yourself. Or just go out as a live speaker, and then I'm going to re-add you. While we wait for Tara to finish up her story, because I actually want to hear what Tara says, because when she says... she enjoys that infatuation. I'm also very much about infatuation. To me, is sexy as hell, right? If you're infatuated with me, like, I'm all yours. I'm going to be infatuated with you, because it's absolutely beautiful. Tara, what I need you to do is go out of the room completely and then come back in. So close the podcast completely. Click on the top, bottom, off the top, like little out. There we go.
She's good. Gone.
Okay, so let's take this time, last for listeners, and let's go on a little commercial break. I mean, what? There's no better time than the present, right? Everything works out perfectly fine. Let's go on to, where's my pen gone to? Yeah, okay. Let's go to slight commercial break. We're going to do it about 10 minutes. Go refill your drinks. Go slip into something comfortable. Slip into your undies. Get that lust brewing with your partner and then join us back in about 10 minutes after the commercial break, because, I mean, we've been talking so much. I need to go refill my water. We love the lots of you. Don't go anywhere. More on lust, love, and everything that we like about it when we return.
I'll have space. And are you completely aware of how do you want to... Hi, my name is Annika. Do you know that feeling of having intimacy with another or with yourself and just not feeling fulfilled? So the question is, do you really know what you want? Do you know how a yes feels in your body and how a no feels in your body? And really from your body and not from a rational headspace? And are you completely aware of how do you want to be touched? And how do you want to touch another? And if you do so, how do you communicate this in a clear and loving way? This and other topics I'm covering in my workshops, and I look forward to welcoming you there. Find me on Facebook or Insta with my name Annika Lipp, AnnikaLipp, or contact me via WhatsApp 079-3517-864. Get in touch with me via my website annikalipp.com or Insta Annika Lipp or Facebook Annika Lipp. So my name is written like this: Annika, AnnikaA, and my surname Lipp, LIPP. Looking forward to hear from you.
Sometimes we're looking for the more, but we just don't know what the more is. And then we come to play with me. Three words, like me, play, toys, fun, games, cheekiness, with, intimacy, connection, relationships, and finally me. It starts with self, and that is something that Play With Me stands for. Play With Me is a place where you have an experience of all of those things. One complete cycle. You're welcome to pop in at our shop at the Gantry in Four Ways, or find us at www.playwithme.co.za. If you're looking for that more, please get in touch.
Ready to deepen in love? Join me on a transformative journey with Tantra. I'm Tara Rose, inviting you into more connection, more intimacy, more love in your relationship with another or with yourself. Tantra is more than sex. It's a path that uses the body for expansion. In our sessions, we can explore bliss, love, emotional pain, ignite your life force energy, and create a safe space for growth. I guide women, men, and couples, in person or online, blending traditional and neo-tantra. This can be a profound journey to deepen your bond with your partner and recognize your true self. Book a discovery call at tararose.net, tararose.net, or message on WhatsApp, +27 76 535 5949. Tantra with Tara Rose. Activate, nourish, and enrich your mind, body, and spirit.
Welcome back, lustful listeners. Or should I say lovely listeners? I mean, is the world going to complain again? If you guys want to complain, contact Auntie Carmen. She's my PR manager, right? So we'll see you get past her. Also, good luck. She's a pit bull. Good evening, lustful listeners. Welcome back to lesson 10 of semester 3 in Lola's lessons. This evening, we're doing a very, very, very exciting one. And honestly, something that everybody should know. Like, schools, can you guys please, like, Mike, do this part of your school training, right? You're supposed to have training on this before you become an adult, because learning this shit when you're an adult sucks, let me tell you. Also, you miss out on real life experiences because you're always forever wondering, am I in love? Am I in lust? Do I love this person? Do I like this person? Or do I just want to have sex with him? So the only way we can figure this out is by learning about this. And we learn about this from this evening. We learn about this from our gorgeous and absolutely fantastic, incredible tantric coaches, Annika and Tara. Welcome back, ladies, and thank you for joining us again. I mean, both of you guys have such incredible and impressive bios that you guys are just the kind of people that I really want to spend time with, because I can learn from you guys, right? And then I can teach it to the last of our listeners. So if you guys have space in Cape Town for Lola and Carmen to come and visit, we're gonna head on over to Cape Town pretty soon. Before the break, last of our listeners, we were listening to Tara, and we were listening about her infatuation with infatuation. Tara, you're back. Thank you so much. Yay, you sound good too.
You can hear me all right. Did I yes, break the internet talking about my infatuation with infatuation?
Yes. I mean, yeah, because you got me infatuated. I think all of that infatuation, the infatuation energy was just too much. Yeah. Tell us a little bit more. I mean, you were busy speaking about your take on infatuation and how that...
Yeah, so I love that, infatuated with infatuation. So I became quite concerned with how I was, like, just the state of my mind and my body during infatuation, so much so that I needed to do a lot of research to figure out what was happening with me. So, and basically in the research that I found, I kind of found the psychological description or theories about love, and the neuroscience theories on love. So it's just kind of like this kind of what is love, of which, you know, lust is an element. It's such a huge, huge, huge topic. It's so vast. So, you know, I think Annika and I are going to do our best just to shed some light on this really massive complex, as Annika said in the beginning, how lust is that in and of itself, it's a very complex emotion. Love is the same. It's very complex. So one can have many theories, which I can go over once we move into love. But yeah, infatuation, I could say as a poet, it fuels a lot of my poetry.
I mean, I think it's a driving force for most people, is being infatuated with something. We've lost Tara again. While we get Tara back, because I can see her talking, but we can't hear her. While we get Tara back, you can go back out and back in again. I don't know what's going on. I want to go back to Annika quickly, because there's still two questions that I've got, right, regarding lust, before we end off that topic. I want to find out, what does lust look like in sex? And what does lust look like in infidelity? Because I mean, Carmen and I had two very, very, very intense weeks. But I don't know if the lustful listeners have caught the last 2 weeks. But we did the cheaters class, and then we did a class on recovering after infidelity. So it was intimacy. It was called intimacy after infidelity. What does lust look like in sex, and what does it look like in for infidelity? What is the correlation between the two, Annika? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so
no, Annika, does, there we go.
Yes. Have you been like, oh gosh, I lost the other one? No, I'm here. So how does lust look in sex? So A, for me, it is definitely an enhancing, it's an enhancing of the lovemaking, but it's also now the question of like, what is sex? What is lovemaking? You know, so we there are so many topics we can, like I said at the beginning, we can talk about all these things for, I guess, at least 3 days. Like, when I'm in lust and I have sex in lust, everything is so much more intense because my sexual energy is so heightened that when someone is touched, it's like, explosion. And here I am talking from not touching my vagina, but touching me wherever. So the focus on the sensation, the intensity of the touch is definitely higher for me. On the other side, could also be like, if I'm very like just horny, then it's like, I just want to be touched. I want to feel you in me. And I personally went into this, oh my gosh, I just want to have an orgasm. My tantric mind comes in and says, no, we don't do that. We are not chasing the orgasm. Yeah, I just want to have an orgasm here. So for me, it is lovely to bring lust into sex. And actually, because I'm not in a relationship. I'm single, but I have 3 lovers. So and when I see them, I'm definitely in lust. So it's a while ago that I have sex without lust, I'm just realizing. Yeah.
Wow, you are living the life.
I know.
I have just gotten myself a new role model.
No, it's really.
I want to be just like Annika when I grow up.
No, it's really, I spoke with Tara earlier and I said, do you know what? Can I have lust for myself? Because this is how my reality is. I'm feeling this like, delicious. And then I'm like, who of my 3 lovers am I calling now? You know, because all of them are great, obviously. Otherwise, they would not be my lovers. But all of them are different. So, okay, I stop there. So I love to have sex and lust together. So now talking about in relationship, and you feel lust, but it's not for your partner. I heard that is happening. My last relationship was an open relationship, so it was not a problem. But I remember back in the days when I had a monogamous relationship, it was a problem. So what are you doing? Like you know, from the beginning when it was about Annika, I'm so into honesty. So I encourage you, if you feel lust for another, communicate that to your partner. And often it's like just communicating this lust feelings, even if it's about another person, it could also do something between the two of you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because we do have lust for others, you know. So I never looked at another. Oops. I'm doubting that this is the truth. Yeah.
Yeah, if I'm with my partner and I just yell out Brad, regardless of what his name is, that's going to be Brad Pitt, right? Even though, I mean, I know he's gotten like the most amount of wrinkles, but gosh, that man just does it for Lola. Goodness gracious. Combs, what do you think? Do you think there's a lot of lust in infidelity? Or is it just being stupid?
No, I do think there's a lot of lust in infidelity, but I mean, we've covered two whole Fridays worth of this. And I think that
it's always because there's potentially something missing in the first place. You know what I mean? Easy to have that burning desire and that sensation when you're missing it elsewhere, you know? But like, you know, one day when I grow up, I want to have Annika's calling. I'm loving that.
Even me. Listen, going on.
Okay, I want to have Annika's calling and I want to be able to say delicious like Tara Rose.
Oh, gosh. Listen, I just want Tara Rose to have her own podcast so that I can listen to her voice all day. Yes. Because goodness. But here's something that I found very interesting, right? And this is something that I preach a lot of on the Lifestyle Lectureship, the Saturday show, right? Because that show is for non-monogamous people. So in that relationship guide, it's also all about communication and where you find lust within a non-monogamous relationship. You don't have to go out cheating. You tell your damn partner, you get consent, and you go and fill your lust. You still come back to your original relationship. I mean, it's a fucking win for everybody. Consent, even your family, even though they don't like you being non-monogamous, trust me, they're happy because you're not going to be getting divorced and shit. So, I mean, each to their own, but communication, like exactly what Annika said, is communication again is key. And it comes up every bloody week. Back to Tara quickly. And actually not quickly, because now we need to know a little bit more about love. This is going to be a long section, right? Okay. You've got an hour and a half. Hypnotize the crap out of us. We just want to listen to you. We've gotten all hot and steamy with Annika now, slipping off our chairs the most. Let's take it down a notch and fall back in love. What does love look like to you? Because I mean, you've got a different perspective of love. I mean, both of you guys coming from a tantric background have a different perspective on love, because I think what I understand, and tell me if I'm wrong, because I could be, but what I understand from a tantric perspective, it all starts with yourself. It all starts with your, like, just being in touch with your own self person. And deriving all of your intimate connections, whether it be, platonic or relationship style, doesn't matter, but deriving all of your intimate connections from them. So what does love look like after lust? After lust, even just start at being in love, how does that look? What does that look like?
I'll speak more to the kind of the tantric approach to love kind of towards the end, because I want to kind of more riff off of what Annika was talking about in terms of lust. Mm. And so, yeah, being like, what did you just say? Being in love. We can even make the distinction between falling in love and being in love.
Yes, that's
that,
true.
That kind of thing. So I that resonates with me, and there'll be different theories that I can bring in as well that kind of speak to this. And maybe I'll just bring in one of them now from a psychological viewpoint. Like, one of them is called the triangular theory of love, which suggests intimacy, passion, and commitment are the core components of love. And then those three, it's kind of like a color wheel. So those three, have you lost me again, or am I?
No, we're listening. We're getting it in the time.
So intimacy, passion, and commitment. So you can.
No.
And there we have lost her.
No.
Yes, I'm telling you, she's just like throwing her fist up in frustration, going, what the actual? Also, I know, like, the whole of South Africa has been having issues with Vodacom all day long. Like, I've got three Vodacom numbers. It's all three of them were off at the same time. It was horrible. So I don't know what connection you're on. I know it's mobile device, so perhaps trying to switch to, if you've got Wi-Fi.
I'm on Wi-Fi.
Yay, ooh, you're back. I don't know how you did that, but that was quick.
No, I'm speaking to you through the WhatsApp call.
Oh, goodness. Okay, well, the listeners can hear. Can the mods just please tell me if the listeners can hear this? Okay, you can talk, Tara. Let's just test this quickly.
Okay. So we're just like flying by the seat of our pants in terms of...
It sounds good on this side, yes.
Sounds brilliant on my side. And yeah, Tara, there we go. Mod said it's go ahead.
Okay, that's great. So just in terms of, so what I was talking about, the triangular theory of love, and it looks at intimacy, passion, and commitment. And so, for example, they say liking only includes intimacy, like emotional intimacy. Infatuation only includes passion. And if you have something like an arranged marriage, that only includes commitment. But romantic love can be a mix of intimacy and passion.
Oh, I like that.
And then, you know, and then what they call, it works up to what's called a consummate love, and that's all three. Intimacy, passion, commitment. And that's a beautiful model, kind of what we're talking about is the ideal, that we have all of those things. And so I think kind of romantic love, you know, as they say, it doesn't include that long-term commitment, but there's lots of passion, there's lots of intimacy. So then, you know, then that kind of hopefully will, you know, if you want it to, will then evolve and to include commitment, planning lives together, buying things together, having children together, that kind of thing. And another person describes as kind of as recent as 1998, she put it into two categories called passionate love, which is intense emotions, sexual attraction, anxiety, affection. And when these are reciprocated, then you feel happy and you feel like, you know.
Now we've missed you. We've lost you again. You were actually talking on the podcast. Definitely talking on. There we go. And you're back.
Okay, great.
Okay, let's just go. Let's just go with it.
Okay, and then compassionate love is like mutual respect, attachment, affection, trust. And she says you move from passionate love to compassionate love. And then lots of people have theories on how long these stages last. So some people, you know, say that lust can last for a few weeks to a few months. Other people say romantic love can last for 6 months up to 2-3 years. And then only that does it go into kind of the more committed kind of love, attached love, that kind of thing. So lots of people have different theories. I mean, I'm quite a romantic, so I like to think that I'm in the kind of the passionate phase and go quite quickly into like real love. And then when it ends after 2-3 years, I'm like, no, how did I even think that was love? What was I thinking?
I love it. Do you think, Tara, do you think when you fall out, when a person falls out of love, do you think there's a quick fix of falling back into love, back in love?
I don't know about a quick fix. I wouldn't say a quick fix, but I would say there's a fix. Yeah, and I think Carmen alluded to it at some point, just saying that, yeah, it does take work. It does take, you know, dedication. It does take commitment. It does take showing up each day, you know, and putting care and attention into the relationship. And when I see couples and there's something that they feel there's missing something in the sexuality, for me, that sexual connection is often like the canary in the coal mine, and in the sense that it's the it's signaling that something isn't right in other aspects of the relating. So perhaps you're just seeing it sexually. So then I want to know, okay, well, what's happening in other ways? Do you feel respected? Do you feel heard? Do you feel met? You know, how early is the foreplay starting in terms of, you know, during the day, like, you know, like I said, the muffins or the kisses or the love notes or, hey, I'm thinking about you, or
a little bit, know, of sexting for Annika.
You know, so it's like these, you know, it does take attention and like being in that state, being in love is actually like an active state of remembering the other person. If, you know, if we're talking about another person.
I love that.
Consideration. Carmen, it's your turn to talk. You've been very quiet. And I know, I can see you making notes.
Oh,
so you're just absorbing everything. And start.
I was just having a look here in the comments, and do you know that you have your wife is a hopeless romantic, so I think that's love.
Oh, no,
and me,
no,
I'm
no,
just straight no. up lust.
That's why you and I are such fire, because we lust and lust together. Tara, tell me, what does love look like? Obviously, you spoke a little bit about it now, right? But what does love look like? A platonic relationship, because look, there's a lot of our listeners that maybe have a BDSM dynamic that aren't necessarily.
Almost.
And there I'm back. Did you guys get me?
Yeah.
There we go. I'm just saying, I'm trying to like, sign language. Just tell the listeners I'm just plugging my mic back in. There we go. Okay, so where was I? So there's a lot of our listeners that might have like a platonic BDSM relationship, right? Where it doesn't necessarily, obviously involves love, because you start caring for that person. Is there a different kind of love, and do we incorporate lust in all of our loving relationships? Or what does it look like in a platonic relationship?
So no, I wouldn't say. Can you hear me? Just making
yes,
sure.
I can. Yes.
I wouldn't say that lust comes across in all relationships or all forms of love. I mean, you know, we speak about, because really, depending on the definition, I mean, the ancient Greek philosophers spoke about six kinds of love that included the love that you have family, like mother, child, you know, parents, children. And then the love between friends, which, you know, I suppose can get lusty, but a different kind of lusty. And then platonic love, self-love, you know, so there's all these different kinds of love. So I think just where, and I'm kind of forgetting the question already, but just love comes in, yeah, more in that romantic love, that eros love, that kind of love, and love, romantic love, where lust can come in, you know, if you're wanting to look at the broader. So platonic, I think, just automatically means there isn't any lust. That's my understanding.
What do you think love looks like in intimacy? Because we've learned throughout this season, right, that intimacy isn't always necessary. Please, guys, if the last few listeners don't know this by now, if you don't know this by now, intimacy isn't only just sex. Okay, it's not being in your partner. That does not mean you are being intimate. Intimacy is pillow talk. Intimacy is caring. Intimacy is having sensuality. Intimacy is doing a bloody boudoir shoot. But listen to Lola's lessons. You'll find out what intimacy is and what it means and what it looks like, right? What does intimacy and love look like, Tara? We've lost Tara. No, listen, what is going on? Podcast gods, this is enough. Okay, we're calling a bloody timeout here. This is not funny anymore. Okay. This is not funny.
One, two, three.
There we go. You're back.
Yes.
Thank you, man.
I've got a pretty stable internet connection, so I'm not sure.
I mean,
so
do I. I don't know what's going on. This is ridiculous.
Talking about love really can break the internet.
Apparently lust too, because we lost the week.
So if you don't mind repeating that question for me, Lola, about
yes, intimacy. What does love look like in intimacy? I mean, what
does intimacy look like in love? I mean, the complex question. So for me, intimacy can be even in that the triangle model of love, where I said, actually, if you just have a friendship, that can be a certain type of intimacy, an emotional intimacy. So, that kind of intimacy that is in love for me is just, Yeah, it's almost like a caring, it's a sharing, what Annika alluded to, it's the honesty, the openness, it's so hard for me to describe, and it's so interwoven in terms of what I think love is. It's sharing moments of the day. It's not just that like raw, passionate sexual intimacy. Mm-hmm. It's the emotional intimacy as well. So emotional intimacy, sexual intimacy, it's both of those things.
And the safety of it all, hey, that for me is also important.
Mm.
Yeah.
I love that you say safety. Because how, like, more often than it should be, we come across relationships with issues where safety is not the number one priority for the spouse, right? Where you are not allowed to voice your conversations. You're not allowed to bring up your issues. You're not allowed to say your concerns. It's also, just like sex is a taboo topic, so is discussing your feelings, right? And that should be like the first thing to go is when you embark on a relationship, make sure that it's safe. I love how you said that, Carmen. Do you think that love enhances or makes intimacy more involved?
For me, and as Tara was so beautifully explaining to us, love encompasses so much communication, closeness. So when you're in that zone and in that space, I think it can enhance lust and intimacy. I'm feeling comfortable enough to share these things with you. And as Annika pointed out earlier, and I love that, is, you know, you can talk about what you lust over. And when you talk about that in love, it is lusty. I am, as much as I have paid attention and made notes to this whole episode and been turned on and, you know, all of those things, I think that they can merge together really well in a wholesome relationship. For me, I want to have all of that together. You know, how we started, when I looked at you and I thought, oh, do you want to sniff your neck? You see, I'm the sniffer. Jeez, it turns out I'm the sniffer. it's that smell that reminds me of that fun time. And it's that, you know, I want to keep that going. And it is possible to keep that going. And for me, I am experiencing that. And I think that is incredibly beautiful. I can't even remember your question. I'm in lust and love at the same time here.
My question was, does love like enhance intimacy or does it make it more complex? Because for me personally, and I have researched love the most because I want to know what love looks like. I want to know what exactly makes me love somebody because I think that's a very interesting topic, right? And from what I have experienced, fuck my life. Love is complex. Love is so many different connections and so many different vibrations and so many different emotions, actually, if you think about it, all put in one. Because I can love you and hate you and lust you and want to murder you and want to bury you, but also want to like lay you down on the floor and just have the roughest sex with you all at the same time. And that is love. I want to bash your bloody windows in and also your skull, but I want to take you on beach walks and like have champagne at sundown because that is love, right? Love is insane. How do we explain something like that? How do you actually even begin to understand a topic as complex as love?
You're very brave to do a podcast on this topic, I must say.
I mean, if nobody's going to do it, I'm going to do it.
No, it's amazing. And I think, you know, just having these conversations is important and just pinging off little ideas and, you know, just having this kind of roundtable conversation is really fantastic.
I think it's important because, look, the whole goal of the whole production series is to keep people together. Because there's way too much distractions in today's society. And I mean, it's really disgusting. And that's why I've got Carmen here with me, with her hand up. Carmen, please save me.
Don't bash my head in. I know you love me, but please don't bash my head in, okay? No, I mean, if you didn't have the big feeling of love,
how could you enhance any kind of intimacy? You know what I mean? Exactly. And if you can't communicate through love and experience love, and even if you're bashing heads in and making me a pina colada at the same time, then there's no intimacy anyway.
No.
It's all of those beautiful things all rolled into one.
Tara, before we end off this love segment, right, I want to find out, do you think that endorphins, because we've learned now, right, when you get into your lust mode, like Annika's favorite lust mode, and she gets all fiery and horny and slipping off chairs and stuff, when those endorphins come rushing to the surface, right, and you have an intimate moment with your partner, do you think those endorphins enhance your love and makes you forget about the lust, or does it enhance both? Or is it a very dangerous and very, very subtle line that could make you forget whether you are in love or in lust?
Okay, so you've segued beautifully into what I wanted to speak about next, which was the neuroscience aspect of love. So actually there are very different chemicals at play at the different stages. So kind of the neuroscience and the biological biological people basically say that, you know, love is like a drive. It's not an emotion, it's a drive, very much like hunger and thirst. The anthropologists, that's what I was looking for. So they kind of look at love is divided into three partly overlapping stages: lust, attraction, and attachment. So lust is sexual desire. Romantic attraction is like what we find attractive. And then attachment is things, you know, we're sharing a home, parental duties, those kinds of things. So lust, the primary hormones in that are testosterone and estrogen for both sexes. Mm-hmm. So that's like that really like fiery feeling, those kinds of things. Not estrogen. Estrogen. Attraction is dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine. I probably didn't pronounce that properly, but very much the attraction is like it's hitting the same things as like drugs do. So when you actually feel like this, like you're in love and that really like falling in love stage, it is very much like being, it's activating the same areas in the brain as when you're on drugs. So that is actually, they've done, you know, the MRI scans and all of that. And then when you move into that kind of more comfortable attachment phase, then the hormones there are oxytocin, which is called the love.
And we've lost Tara again. She's super frustrated there. I can just see that face. She's super frustrated. While we get Tara back, comms, what do you think the endorphins has? What effect do you think it's got on love versus lust?
I think perhaps sometimes it could have a blinding effect. You know what I mean?
When right, because sex fixes everything.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, but how's that, hey? The love drug. It is. It's a love drug. Never quite considered it that way before. The neuroscience part of it is incredibly interesting.
I love that. Annika, what's your experience when it comes to love versus lust and the endorphins thereof? Oh, no, can't hear Annika either.
What
is going on tonight? This is ridiculous.
I mean, like, my favorite voice keeps disappearing. Yes, this is not okay for me.
There we go.
I'm running out of endorphins. Okay.
This is okay. Tara, we've got you back. Let's hear that voice. Yes, Tara.
Great. So, I missed there, but in terms of just the different, so you're asking me, so that like they often say that, you know, there's overlapping and that kind of moves into the other. So when you're, I guess the question is like when you're in the attachment phase with oxytocin and vasopressin, can you get back the testosterone and the estrogen kind of phase? You know, is it dangerous? I mean, I've been in a situation and maybe a lot of your listeners would agree, understand, the ones that are in the non-monogamous situation where you have a long-term partner, so you're experiencing those, that kind of attachment phase, and then a new person comes in and you have that new relationship energy, which is a lot of that testosterone and things like that. So it does happen. And your question is like, can that new relationship energy happen with your existing partner? And I think what Annika is saying, you know, it's like it's a mindset. It does take work. How do Esther Perel, who's an amazing relationship love expert, speaks about that safety versus excitement. And it's hard to, you know, once you have the safety, you don't have the excitement. So how do you bring in both? And I think, it's a very good question in terms of keeping that lustfulness alive.
And balance.
I kind of go a little bit more the monogamish route. And that ties into what Annika was saying, that if you find you have lust for someone else, how can I bring that into my committed relationship? And play with that, with the ideas of it and the heat of it and things like that, but bring it in.
I mean, now that you mention it, in a monogamous relationship, can we still share fantasies and lust over others without having a partner think that it's an infidelity experience? I mean, why can't we use that? Why can't we share that with our partners and go on that journey together? And I think we've lost Tara again.
Have you lost me?
Oh. No, there you're back.
No, there you go. So yeah, that's kind of called monogamish. And, you know, the main thing with all of these things is that both parties have to be on the same page. So if both parties are like, hey, I don't mind you talking about Brad Pitt or whoever, just as long as I know I'm the one you're going to be with all the time, that you love me, that you're choosing to build a life with me. So it just depends on, you know, on that kind of both people being on the same page. And I don't think there's anything wrong with, you know, getting help, going for counseling, just around these things to both get on the same page. Absolutely not.
And I mean, sometimes fantasies don't need to involve other people either. I mean, I had an interaction once where a fantasy was shared with me, and it was, I just want you to be on a bed in a room full of balloons. It's like, wow, that's beautiful. Okay. But I don't know.
It wasn't mine. That wasn't my fantasy. I'm just saying. I'll be slightly more creative.
Yes, on that first balloons pop, say, can you imagine?
Unless it's water balloons, that's going to be water sports.
The thing is, it doesn't have to involve another physical human being. And I think there's something, I mean, very lustful in discussing those things with your partner. You know, you don't ever have to actually carry out the fantasy. It's in the talking of it that is so exciting.
It also goes back to what Annika was saying a little bit earlier, is when the foreplay starts, right, having these discussions, I mean, whilst the both of you are at work, texting, you know, these fantasies, I mean, throwing me over the kitchen counter on, like, the bonnet of the car in the garage and just making sure the neighbors don't hear, right? This is all part of getting that excitement, right, Annika? That's what you were referring to.
Yes, absolutely. And I just want to mention one more thing. I liked it when Tara said it's very important that both of us, and the partner and I, in this case, for example, on the same page. And what is very, very important, it's an ongoing journey for me, and I recommend it to all of you, is the self-love. Because I just can feel like, oh my gosh, he wants to sleep with Jennifer Aniston instead of me. You know, that is just like, if I love myself and I know how amazing and incredible I am, and this person is just sharing that he finds the other woman attractive, also hearing that, it's not against me. It's such an honor that my partner is able to share that he has lust for another.
Yes.
But the love is hopefully then with me. So if I see that people can't handle that. And I'm not saying that I can handle that all the time very well. I feel if I, for example, like I said in my last relationship, which was an open one, and the other person loves it about over someone, and I couldn't manage that very well, I realized I was just not very in balance. I didn't haven't had my enough self-love for myself. Because if partner shares that with you, it's an honor. It's an honor. The partner trusting you that you take it as it is. It's just the lust. And I'm definitely also going for Brad Pitt.
Oh, we can share. How's that? We'll share. I'll share my Brad Pitt, but I won't share my Carmen. That's one I'm keeping for myself. Tara, do you have something to add to that?
Yeah, I just want to say with that, and in what and to further add to what Annika's saying is that there's also just like being with your partner where they're at. So if that is shared, you know, if that's shared and you're feeling uncomfortable, then it could also be like, wow, I'm actually feeling really uncomfortable. You know, do you mind holding me in this? I'm not sure what's going on because I know you love me and I know you're committed to me, or actually, I just need you to tell me that you love me and then you can say it again. But just really meeting each other in that negotiation, validation, in that discussion, really sharing whatever comes up. Mm. So, wow, that makes me feel anxious. Okay, what do you need? That kind of thing. So really meeting each other in it. Mm. But yeah, if you keep on flaring up every time Jennifer's, you know, being mentioned, then it's also, it could be triggering something much bigger that has nothing to do with Jennifer. And then you can maybe something that you want to sort that out with a therapist, with a friend, something like that. But yeah, bringing things like that to the relationship, seeing how you guys can hold it with love, with respect, with commitment, with care.
I think that's absolutely beautiful.
You missed something. With deliciousness. I didn't hear that part.
Yes, with deliciousness.
With deliciousness.
Oh, yes.
With deliciousness.
Oh my gosh. You are an incessant Tara fan. Carmen is such a Tara fan. So, lustful listeners, this evening we did this segment on lust and love. And yes, there's a big correlation between the two of them, right? You really want to get to a sweet spot in your relationship, you need to have both aspects. And I think from what we've learned this evening, that a successful relationship dynamic and a successful intimacy journey, one cannot live without the other. You're going to have to learn to have a little bit of love and a little bit of lust, because together they make something absolutely beautiful. Carmen, can we please get the listeners, the lustful listeners, to a place where they are absolutely in lovable lust for the rest of eternity, because we won't have any damaging intimacy moments at all ever again. Then we have succeeded in our life. Tara, you've got your hand up there.
Yes, I just wanted to, you know, as I hear you kind of winding off, and I did say that I would bring it in from a classical tantric perspective. Mm. You know, it's just, we are love.
Mm.
We are love. So it's not this thing of like, I'll only be able to get love from the other. And it's like, we are love. It's a state of existence. It's not even an emotion. It's not a fantasy. It's not an action. It's not a reaction. You know, it's you are love.
Mm.
So just also kind of remembering that from a more kind of spiritual place.
I think that's something that we talk about quite often, right, Carmen, is the fact that, and I've said it a couple of times, how can you teach somebody else how to love you if you don't love yourself? If you haven't explored enough, found yourself, found your triggers, found your likes, found your dislikes, find your upset place, find your happy place. If you don't know where those places are, how the hell are you going to teach your partner where they are? Teaching your partner where those places are, that's teaching your partner to love you. in the way that you need to be loved. If you're not going to be loved in the way that you need to be loved, you're not going to be happy. Right? We've spoken about this, comms.
Yeah, we definitely have, you know. But I think sometimes we're on the quest to try and fix the things and find the answers when we already have all of them.
That's so
you
true.
Know, sometimes you just need to be and everything will be well. I consider myself very loved tonight. I've had front row seats to all of this. Okay, I'm so lucky.
I mean, I think everybody listening is very lucky. I think, personally, I feel very, very fortunate to have had an opportunity to have this discussion and to teach this discussion, right? To give the listeners something to think about, something to ponder on, something to consider, something to discuss. Because that's where it starts, right? Is having that discussion, opening up and like giving a safe space, like we said earlier. Annika, before we close off, is there anything else that you wanna add? And then I'll go back to Tara and then we'll say goodnight. That's horribly sad.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks for asking. Yes. Lola, I really like that you said like you want to make sure that the people are staying together. You phrase it differently, and I'm absolutely with you. But I also would like to that when you're in a relationship, maybe not 10 years, but 1 year, whatever, maybe less, that you also have a look at, is it maybe just lust? Mm. Because if the, like we said already, we need both and we definitely need love. Mm. So it is really like if you're thinking of the other person and it's more physical and you just want to have intimacy, and actually you don't care if they had a pet when they were a child, it's very likely that it's not love. So by just asking yourself some questions, if you can find out, is it really just sexual and the attraction on the physical base, or is it really that I really see and love all the flaws? I don't want to change the other person. I want to have this emotional connection with them. I so care for them even more than for myself, which is a little bit dangerous in my point of view. Yeah. So if you're in a relationship for a couple of months, it's good to check, how do you really feel about the other person? And if it's just lust, like with my lovers, it's awesome, but I'm aware of it. Yeah. I have lust with them and I like them, but I don't love them. And this brings back to honesty, honesty with yourself and honesty with the others.
Mm. I think that's also very, very, very sound and solid advice for all of the non-monogamous listeners, because we've got a lot of them listening in to these lessons, the sex education lesson on a Friday night, because that is what drives the non-monogamous folk, right? Is they all chase that contractive orgasm. It's very important. As soon as that lust turns into love, you are now moving into a dangerous relationship facet, especially if you guys are swingers. Yep. All those swingers, all you swingers, I know Lola has a lot of swingers listening. You guys, let's stay away from love. Oh, let's stay away from love. Keep on with the lust. That's absolutely wonderful. When you find that person, let's go to love. The other ones, like, let's stay with lust. Lust is sexy. Lust is hot. Tara, do you have anything else to add before we leave? And we can't hear anything again. This is horrible. Let's just give it a minute. There we go, you're back.
I'm back, okay. So now I was just saying that I really, thanks, Annika. That was really beautiful, what you said. And it's actually whatever I was going to say went out the window. Oh, it's what Carmen was saying, that how you said just being in this environment, having this front row seat, and you're feeling very loved. And I think that's one of the things, it's like when we talk about it, we feel it. So if you just talk about, like, what does love feel like for you? You feel it in your body and you kind of like marinate in that feeling, you're in it. And then the same would be for lust. Like Annika said, when she was doing all the research, it was like, whew, this is hot, researching lust. So, you know, just like remembering what lust feels like, bringing it into your body, you know, that kind of thing. It's like sometimes like when, you know, we are what we long for. So if we're longing for lust, bring that in, speaking about it, and feeling it in your body, making it a very embodied experience when you think about it. I mean, yeah, I could take you guys on a little hypnosis journey, but maybe we'll save that for another time.
Oh, damn it. That's why I signed in tonight. Carmen's going, I'm unhappy, I quit. That's not what I signed up for.
Shortchanged.
Annika and Tara, thank you guys so, so, so much for joining us this evening. I think, and I knew it, I called it right from the start. The two of you just did this episode so, like, the most amount of justice. And I cannot thank you two enough. You guys did. Oh, gosh, I've got goosebumps. Thank you so, so, so much. Absolutely prime. I've learned something. And if I've learned something, that means the Lustful listeners definitely have a lot of notes that they can put in that relationship bag of theirs, that toolbox. Comms, how are you feeling? Are you, I mean, I know you're feeling shortchanged, but besides for that.
But extremely grateful. But I realized when Annika was having a chat earlier about love and checking in, is that I haven't checked in on your toe in quite some time. So I do care about
really?
Your toe.
Really? Are we doing this? I mean, my false toenail actually just broke this afternoon. I'm not happy. I'm really not happy. This is really a problem for me. It really upsets me. Like, I want my real toenail to grow back out. Okay, but on that high, I mean low toenail.
no. It's love. It's all love, okay? This is my point.
I mean, yes, love is caring about the little things. Also, yes. Not little toys. We like the most amount of big toys from Play With Me. That's where we shop for it. If any of the Lustful listeners missed that, there's a toy shop in Four Ways, Lone Hill, South Africa. Go and visit Miss Calms at Play With Me in Lone Hill at the Gantry Lifestyle Center and go and buy toys. I don't know how we got from speaking about love and lust to toys, but we got to promote that shit, right? Also, you got to, all of the Lustful listeners then have a chance to spend time with my wife, and that's going to make me very, very jealous. With this evening, we did a segment called Lust and Love for those of you who have just joined us. If you want to re-listen to this episode, you guys can head on over to lelustfm.podbean.com. All of the episodes right from the first season up until tonight is loaded there. Otherwise, you guys can go through to Lola's website. That's www.lelustyeslelovelies. That's with a double L. lelustfm.live. All of the episodes will link back to Podbean, obviously. But there you can also go and learn a little bit more about all of the different co-hosts that we've got for the different segments. We have had the most amount of fun this evening. Also, we've really learned a lot of perspectives, and we've got all of those nuggets, as Carmen would like to call them. What is to come in Lola's lessons? I mean, we're nearly done. Carmen, can you believe it? This was supposed to be only 10 episodes. You bullied me. Blondie, you bullied me, because now we've still got two left. I was supposed to be on leave after tonight, madam. Next week, Lola's lesson.
You like it?
I mean, I'm really excited for next week's one. Next week, Carmen and Lola take to the air again Friday night, 9 o'clock, same time, same place, because we are talking about Dale's dirty secrets. Who the hell is Dale, and why does she have dirty secrets? Trust me, this is going to be laughable. And that's all I'm saying. You guys don't want to miss this. It's Dale is a comedian. She's got a very, very, very successful comedy show where they discuss sex. And if we can't laugh about sex, we can't enjoy sex, right? Because sex isn't always as you see in the movie. Sometimes, I mean, the poop sits on the finger. And sometimes you bump your head against the wall. Oh, and sex can be funny. Also, what was that bush one that you saw on Instagram that she was trimming a bush? What was that joke that she...
It was about the floss.
The floss.
It was about floss.
Yes, sometimes you're going to have a little floss during an intimate moment. Let's learn about what exactly makes sex such a fun and a laughable topic to discuss. The week after, we finally break for production break. But before we do, Carmen has bullied me into being the person that will be interviewed, and she's going to be the interviewee. So I'm Lola gets put in the hot seat. Carmen does all the talking. I mean, you're going to have to learn how to work the equipment too, right? If you want to do it, you got to do it all. Yes?
Okay, but listen, we all know I'm not going to be doing all the talking.
Okay, fine.
You're going to dump me and stuff.
Fair enough. Look, you guys don't really want to miss that episode, because that episode, we're going to recap the whole season as well. We might even let the last listeners into a little secret about what we're planning for this next season to come. We're going to take a little bit of a production break after that, but trust me, we're going to be back. We're going to be lustful, we're going to be learning, and we're going to do it with love. This evening our guests were Annika and Tara, and we did a beautiful segment on lust and love and what it looks like from both perspectives. Thank you to the guests, and thank you to Carmen for this episode. And don't forget to tune in next week, same time, same place. We love the lot of you. Good night, lustful listeners. Why is it coming? What an episode.